Honorable Deputy Speaker, sir.
Deputy Chairman.
Deputy Chairman, sir. It has been very timely thinking from the part of the Parliament that electoral reforms have been taken up as a matter of discussion. I am thankful to the House for asking me to initiate this discussion, and I shall try to do justice to the responsibility given to me. I am standing on behalf of All India Trinamool Congress and my leader, Ms. Mamata Banerjee, always insisting for electoral reform, state funding, etc., etc. We parliamentarians respect the largest democracies of the world, and it was a gift of their leaders of the country. Following independence on August 15, 1947, the peoples of India to decide their own fate and gave the ultimate power in the hands of the people. As rightly said by Abraham Lincoln, democracy is for the people, of the people, and by the people. So whenever we talk of democracy, we talk of people's rights, which is linked to aspiration and desire to get an improved quality of life. Democracy gives the right to people to choose their own government, but we parliamentarians will fail if we do not facilitate peoples to choose a right government. If democracy is used as a tool to manipulate formation of a government, which has not been the true desire of the peoples, democracy fails to function in true spirit. Election at regular interval is the most important feature of the democracy. Election reflects the attitude, values, and beliefs of the people towards their political environment. While it also grants people a government and vests with the government the constitutional right to govern those who elect it. Election at the central democratic procedure for selecting and controlling leaders. Election symbolizes the sovereignty of the people. Thus, free and fair election are indispensable for the success of democracy, and political parties that take part in the election should become instrument in achieving the constitutional goal set out in the preamble and para 3 and 4 of the Constitution of the India. India opted for parliamentary democracy in continuance of the British legacy. Since 1952, the country has witnessed elections to the legislative bodies at both the national as well as state level. The Indian democracy is considered as the world's largest democracy in terms of size, but when it comes to the question of quality, the World Press Organization has ranked it 68th in 2014 and up from 70th in 2012. A small country like Norway has been ranked first in the quality of democracy and Switzerland second. Thus, there is a lot of room left to improve upon the system of electioneering in India and improve upon system of democracy that can fully comprehensive reflect the people's will. The Election Commission of India, as a guardian of free and fair polls, has always been proactive in removing obstacles in the way of free and fair polls. It has made a number of recommendations and repeatedly reminded the government the necessity of changing the existing laws to check the electoral malpractices. The Tarakunda Committee report of 1975, the Goswami Committee report of 1990, the Election Commission's recommendation in 1998, and the Indojit Committee report of 1998 produced a comprehensive set of proposals regarding electoral reform. The Election Commission of India by itself has been trying to bring improvements in election procedure, and the introduction of electronic voting machine has brought revolutionary change, promising free and fair polls. While EVMs have improved efficiency in voting, it is believed to have reduced malpractices. The EVMs were first tried in the state of Kerala during the year 1982 Legislative Assembly election. After the successful testing and inquiries of the technology aspects, EVMs were used in 16 assembly constituencies in the state of Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and Union Territory of Delhi. Later in the June 1999 assembly election, Goa became the first state to successfully use EVM in all its assembly constituencies. In 2014 Lok Sabha election, the machines were used all over the country. These initiatives made the electoral process simple, quick and troubleful. It has saved money, solved several logistic issues and also contributed to the conservation of environment through the saving paper. Another major advantage of these machines is that the counting of votes became more fast and accurate. But unfortunately, now the political parties recently have raised doubts about the functioning of the EVM machines. And these create doubts in the minds of millions of Indians whether these machines are really managed and manipulated and whether these machines alternate the vote cast by the people. To me, the Election Commission of India should take appropriate care of this concern to assure the people that EVM are not hindrance to true reflection of people's will and it cannot be tempered to alter result to one's advantage. This very elementary aspect has started posing question to the functioning of the democracy and this should be satisfactorily replied. However, talking about the ongoing reform, the use of information technology enabled the Election Commission Secretariat to get directly connected with nearly 1,500 counting centers across the country in the 1999 Lok Sabha polls. The round-wise counting results were fed into the Commission's website from those counting centers. These results were instantly available throughout the world. The Commission had, in cooperation with the state-owned media, Doordarshan and All India Radio, taken several innovative and effective steps to create awareness among voters. All recognized national as well as state parties were allowed to free access to the state-owned media on the extensive scale for their election campaign. During the 2004 general elections, the total free time allotted to the political parties was 122 hours. Another major step was in computerization of the electoral rolls in 1998, where in the printed electoral roll, as well as series containing these rolls were made available to the general public and national and state parties. By 2009 general election, the Election Commission also decided to introduce photo electoral rolls for proper verification of the voters across the country. So India has continuously witnessed electoral reforms and upgradation of its democratic process, but there is still a need to make it more relevant and responsive. The Law Commission of India submitted its 255th report titled Electoral Reforms to the Ministry of Law. The 261-page report, prepared in response to a request by the then government in January 2013 to consider the issue of electoral reform in its entirety and suggest comprehensive measures for change in the law. These reports need to be read with the 244th report of the Law Commission titled Electoral Disqualifications, submitted on 24 February 2014 in response to a Supreme Court order passed on 15 December 2013. The two reports together provide a comprehensive assessment of the entire electoral system and how to make it more relevant and responsive. The Standing Committee on Law and Justice submitted its reports on Election Reforms Code of Conduct for Political Parties and Anti-Defection Law on August 26, 2013, and its recommendation needs to be duly considered. But with big changes coming in the entire electoral process and conducting the polls become more and more technical and in its persuasion, to achieve accuracy, one needs to review the structure of the Election Commission, which undertake the human tasks of conducting the polls. There was a long-standing demand to make the Election Commission a multi-member body. The Supreme Court in the SS Dhawana versus Union of India case had observed, when an institution like the Election Commission is entrusted with the vital functions and it's armed with exclusive and uncontrolled powers to execute them, it is both necessary and desirable that power not exercised by one individual, however wise he may be. It also conforms to the tenets of democratic rules. With the 1993 Constitution Amendment Act, the Election Commission was made a multi-member body. The EC was made a multi-member body by the government and in the wake of certain controversial decision taken by the Chief Election Commissioner T.N. Sishan. The Act provided the decision of the all members shall as far as possible be unanimous. But in case of difference of opinion among the members, the matter shall be decided according to the opinion of the majority. It was a significant step to remove a one-man show in such an important function as that of conducting election. A single member AC would have no longer unbridled power. In view of the large size of the country and the huge electorals, the Election Commission has also made a proposal for the appointment of regional commission to different zones to reduce its burden. To my opinion, it is now time that we have moved a step ahead and make the Election Commission of India more democratic body. That the temple of democracy should justify itself with more democratic procedures so that stakeholders at any point of time does not feel itself a victim of prejudice. The Election Commission of India is absolute, and there is no regulation in its functioning, especially during the course of the election. If there arise any grievances against the functioning of the Election Commission, there is no mechanism to address. Should there be in a democracy like India, grievances during the polls should go unheard and we wait to be redressed unless the elections are over. When the challenge is to make the elections more free and fair, sir, give a few minutes time, sir, I will conclude. Free and fair, have more and more transparency in the system and get a reflection of people's opinion as accurate as possible. Law has to see on the aspects of unbridled power vested on a group of people. Law should break it under certain frameworks of regulation which make the Election Commission of India more liable to its people's will. In a democracy, what we say the aim has to eliminate arbitrary and discretionary use of powers. If we can do so only, then we will be able to achieve our constitutional goals. Another important aspect which I want to deal with, and I am sure every member in the House is keen, is that of election funding. Our leader and I, All India Trinamool Congress, is always insisting upon the state funding. Our finance minister, in his budget speech, has given an outline on funding political parties, which definitely will have a bearing on election funding. Limiting cash donation, sir, limiting cash donation rupees 2000 and introducing election bonds has an attempt towards cleansing the funding system. But electoral reforms announced in the budgets are actually not what they are claimed to be. A journalist has written, and I quote, "The devil is in fine print." Now what or who is the devil? The finance minister has proposed limiting cash donation to rupees 2000 for anyone donations. Everyone believed that the slab for anyone anonymous contribution has been reduced from 20,000 to rupees 2000. But the reality lies in the fact that the existing limit of 20,000 in the Representative of the People's Act has remained untouched, and the finance minister seems to have added another clause that limit can cash donation from one source to rupees 2000. This needs to be clarified, otherwise it will breed controversies. Finance minister has talked about electoral bonds, But the part that says about the redemption of bonds are not clear. It says that party's bank would know the amount deposit through the bond, but not amount the donor, not about the donor. So neither the EC nor the income tax authorities come to know about the donor, and therefore another fishy ground on funding has been created. I think it reforms
okay,
to be done in two sense. There should not be any fishy ground left. Funding has to be crystal clear, which will bring real confidence in the minds of the people. I would propose the House to consider state funding for funding the election, and these will bring about restriction in matters of election expenditure, while maintaining accounts would be an easier and transparent affair. A corpus under the management of the Election Commission can be formed, and the funds from the said corpus can be distributed according to the principles and guidelines of the EC. But the broad principle of the distribution should be based on the theory of proportionate distribution, and that can be availed by the candidates of the registered party
okay.
in equal position. But any reform initiated
extra
should be on the basis of consensus and clarification
extra
of draft reform document can be circulated to all stakeholders as a primary resolution. I wish all the best to all the members
no
of the
speech.
Parliament for taking part in the discussion as well as for taking up the agenda of electoral reform. Thank you, Simon.
Thank you very much.